When you call upon my name, be assured that I will answer. When you are in Canaan, I appeared to you. You built me an altar, and I accepted your labor and sacrifice. But dear friend, why must you doubt my promise? I had given you my word, my utmost blessing and protection. Why must you deceive people about your wife Sarah? Didn't you trust me at all when I said that I will bless your life? When I blessed you, that meant your whole life, including your family. Trust me. Believe my word, dear friend. Faithfully yours, God.
Praise God. Good afternoon, church. Good afternoon, church. I want to see the excitement in your faces, in your smiles. I hope when you say that, it's really from your heart. Amen. And today, we will be in our second Sunday of our series, Faithfully Yours, God. All right, some people, they thought I will stop there because you like the Telus area. All right, but Faithfully Yours, God. And I'm going to take you to the Word of God. One thing is I always take our video team for the wonderful clips that we have seen as part of the introduction of our message. Turn your Bibles with me in Genesis chapter 12, verses 10 to 20. Genesis chapter 12, verses 10 to 20. Please stand up in reverence of God's Word. Follow me as I read it. Now there was a famine in the land, and Abraham went down to Egypt to live there for a while because the famine was severe. As he was about to enter Egypt, he said to his wife Sarai, "I know what a beautiful woman you are. When the Egyptians see you, they will say, 'This is his wife.' Then they will kill me, but will let you live. Say you are my sister, so that I will be treated well for your sake, and my life will be spared because of you." When Abraham came to Egypt, the Egyptians saw that she was a very beautiful woman, and when Pharaoh's officials saw her, they praised her to Pharaoh, and she was taken to his palace. He treated Abraham well for her sake, and Abraham acquired sheep and cattle, male and female donkeys, men servants and maid servants and camels. But the Lord inflicted serious diseases on Pharaoh and his household because of Abraham's wife Sarai. So Pharaoh summoned Abraham. "What have you done to me?" he said. "Why didn't you tell me she was your wife? Why did you say she is my sister so that I took her to be my wife? Now then, here is your wife. Take her and go." Then Pharaoh gave orders about Abraham to his men, and they sent him on his way with his wife and everything he had. Once again, Lord, you speak to us through your word. And Father, we thank you for your, we know that you're a faithful God. And Lord, once again, reveal yourself to us this morning, this afternoon, O God. And I pray for each and every one that you open our hearts so that we may listen to you and understand you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. We're going to have a little review of what we have taken last Sunday. And Pastor Ronald's message to us is the beginning of the life of Abraham. Before he became Abraham, his name is Abraham. And we have learned last Sunday that God called Abraham. And because of Abraham's faith, we know that Abraham's background is he's not from a religious family. Abraham, who is the father of faith, his background is not a church background. He grew up not in a believer family oriented. You see, one thing about Abraham is he grew up in a family of idol worshiper. And we have learned last week from Pastor Ronald that God called him. It means that God called each and every one of us, no matter what your background is. And we can see there that Abraham followed God. Followed God, and by faith he walked, even though he doesn't know which way to go. He doesn't know the land that God called him to. And one thing is, before I give you the message, the main points today, I want you to understand that God called Abraham and God called each and every one of us not just to take us to the promised land. We know that God's calling in Abraham is go, leave your parents, leave your father's household, leave everything your father's had, and go to a place where I'm going to send you, which is the promised land. We know that. But let me tell you this, that God called each and every one of us not just to take us to the promised land, but for us to experience God in this journey. God called us not just to put us in a comfortable place. God called us not just to put us in a happy place. God called us not just to put us in a blessed life called promised land. God didn't call us just to settle. Let me tell you this, friends. God called us to journey. It's not just the promised land. It's about the journey. What God is after is the beauty of the journey. Because in that journey, we are going to know Him in our life. In that journey, we're going to experience Him in our life. In that journey, God is going to reveal Himself to us in every situation of our life. In this journey, we will see how faithful God is. With Abraham, it's not just about the promised land. With Abraham, it's not just about the son. With Abraham, it's not just a race or about a nation. It is about God who will reveal His nature in every event of His life. And that's the same promise that God has for us. When we abide in that call of God in our life, God is going to reveal Himself to us. You know, when God called us to journey, listen carefully, it always comes with a promise. Oh, I like that. You know, some of us, when we say, there's a promise, oh, that's what I'm waiting to hear. You know, we love promises so much. And in fact, we are deceived with a lot of those promises, right? I'm not sure if even your marriage is something like that. That a lot of us are being promised the sun, the moon, and the stars by our husband. But after 5 years, not even a fishbowl, you know. So when God called us to journey, remember, God always give a promise. And the promises of Abraham, because I want this introduction because this is something to do with the message. You see, the promise of God to Abraham is sevenfold. It's one promise, but sevenfold. So I want to take you to the promises. But before I do that, a lot of pastors and preachers, they don't agree, or they thought that the promises of God to Abraham doesn't apply to us. The promise of God to Abraham is just to Abraham. Yes, literally speaking, yes. Literally speaking, if we will take the context of the Bible in Genesis chapter 12, literally it's for Abraham. It's not for you and that's for me. All right? So if you are still waiting for a child and you're claiming the promise for Abraham, well, you deal it with the Lord, all right? Well, I'll be honest with you. God makes miracle in our life. I believe in that. Don't get me wrong. But what I'm saying is the sevenfold promise of God to Abraham, they say that it's not for us. Well, let me tell you this. I always believe that the promise of God to Abraham is the same promise of God to each and every one of us. And let me tell you this. If you're going to understand the promises literally, I'll take you to that sevenfold very quick. The first promise of God, turn your Bibles again in chapter 12, verse 2. All right? This is the promise to Abraham when he followed God's calling. Number one, the first promise of God is this to Abraham. And then after that, I will tell you what it is in our life. First one is, I will make you into a great nation. One thing about God is when God called us and we obeyed trust the Lord with all of our heart, fully surrender our life, God is making a nation out of us. When we follow God's call in our life, from us will come a generation. From our life will come a nation. From our life will come a race. When we talk about race, we're talking about family. When we follow God's calling in our life, He is going to raise a family out of you. He is going to raise a household of faith out of my life. So once we follow God, that promise is also for us. And second to that, in verse 12, and I will bless you. Wow! This is we always hear this, I will bless you. God's promise is I will bless you. But listen carefully. Be careful with this, because when God says I will bless you, not the way we understand blessing. Because when we talk about blessing, the first thing that will come to your mind is material blessing or things that have your personal gain. Well, let me tell you this. The true meaning of this, when God says, I will bless you, God is telling Abraham, you will not run out. You will not run out of. And God is telling each and every one of you and me that when we follow God's call in our life, when we obey God's call in our life will never run out. It means this God who called Abraham, this God who says, I am, He will be your I am. If you have nothing, God says, I am your provider. If you are sick, let me tell you this, God will show you, will bless you. I am your healer. If you are down, God will tell you, I am your banner. I am your great shield. So when we follow God's call in our life, He says, I will bless you. And the third one, I will make your name great. I will make your name great. I always believe when we follow God's call in our life, this is a promise of God to each and every one of us. When God says, I'm going to make your name great, you will be known to people. But anyway, you're not going to be known to people because of GMA 7 or Channel 2 or, you know, being actors or actors. No. I'm not talking about fame. When God calls us, our name, you know, your life, my life, our name will be a reflection of God's glory. That whenever people see you and say, oh, this Matthew, oh, by the way, this Luke, it's a reflection of God's glory. And number four, the fourth blessing to Abraham and to us who will follow God's call is you will be a blessing. You will be a blessing. God will use us to bless other people. Amen. Well, sometimes when we think about blessing, we only think of what we can get, but we're not even thinking of what we will be, you know, what God will use our life for to give others. Well, let me tell you this. When we follow God's call, God will use us to bless other people. And number five, I will bless those who bless you. I will bless those who bless you. Because God promised that He's going to bless you and He's going to use other people to bless you. Let me tell you this. God's blessing will be extended to those people. God's blessing will be extended to those people who will bless you. God's blessing will be extended to those people who will bless me. Well, in fact, I love the story in the Bible about Joseph. You know what? When Joseph was taken to Egypt, you know, and he was taken by Pharaoh. Remember when he became the second in command? What happened to Pharaoh? He was blessed by God because of the God of Joseph. And not only that, even Daniel. You know the story of Daniel, right? When Daniel became governor in Babylon, let me tell you, Babylon was blessed because of Daniel. And because of your life, because of my life, when we respond to God's call, God will use us to bless other people. Number six, I will curse those who curse you. What does it mean by this? This is about God's protection. That each and every one of us who follow God, we have God's protection from the enemy who wants to destroy us. Well, some of you will say, but how come I still feel pain? How come other people still do this to me and do that to me? Where's God's protection? Let me tell you, God has His own way. God has His own vengeance. Remember what the Lord says? Vengeance is mine, says the Lord, because God has His own time, and He will curse those who curse you, and God will curse those who curse me. You know, I remember we don't need to say those famous words that most of the young people in the Philippines always say. You know, when we are being cursed by other people, when other people do bad things to us, you know, those those people, they say, bullet day, I will giant you. I know you don't understand that. It's a deep English. You know, the young people in the Philippines, they always say that, you know, you bullet day, I will giant you. What does it mean? Bullet means balang. Day is araw. Giant, paghihigantihan. You. So, balang araw, paghihigantihan kita. So, bullet day, I will giant you. You know, God, because we have God's protection in our life. All right? And all of the people, the seventh promise of God is all the people on earth will be blessed through you. You know what? Because of Abraham's obedience to God, all people on the earth was blessed because the Messiah came from the seed of Abraham. Let me tell you, when you obey God's call in your life, through your life will become a legacy in which God will be glorified. Amen. So always claim those seven promises in your life because it's yours and it's mine as well. Okay? That's just an introduction. And I will go to the main point. Last week, Abraham obeyed the Lord. And let me just tell you that even in our obedience, even when we follow God wholeheartedly, there are times in our life that our faith will be tested. There are times in our life that our trusting and obeying God will be tested. Remember what I told you? It doesn't stop in the promised land. It is not about the promised land. It is about a journey. Abraham reached the promised land. Abraham started walking and surveying the land of Canaan, which is God is going to give him. When Abraham reaches, God has to see if his faith remains in him. You know what happened? There was a severe famine in the promised land. There came a severe famine in Canaan. You know, let me tell you this. Even if you are in the center of God's will, a lot of people thought that they're in the center of God's will, they will not be experiencing this famine in their life. Let me tell you, even if you are in the center of God's will, your faith and my faith will be tested in different ways. And things, listen carefully, things might fall apart temporarily. Things might fall apart temporarily. But it is a test of faith if we will remain firm in trusting our Almighty God. It is a test of faith if we are firm in trusting and obeying our Savior. It is a test if we will remain standing in the promises of God. The title of my message today is Standing in the Promises of God. It's a very old hymn that some of you, I'm not sure if you know, but Standing in the Promises of God. One thing that happened is famine strikes the land. You know, when we experience those things in our life, question starts coming to us, right? And sometimes we ask, am I in the center of God's will? And you know, sometimes when you talk to believers, you know what? I am experiencing these troubles in my life. I'm experiencing this hardship in my life. Am I in the center of God's will? And some believers will tell you, have you prayed hard about it? But many times in your life, yes, you really have to pray hard about it. I'll talk to you about that later. But there are times in your life that even though you have prayed for something and you know that that is God's will in your life, let me tell you this, you will experience famine. Because you must see if you're really, really trusting and obeying God. How do we exactly know if we are in the center of God's will? Before I talk to you about the promises, how do we really know we are exactly in the center of God's will? You cannot say what Pastor Ronald mentioned to us last Sunday, you know what? God spoke to me that you are, you know, the one for me. I was sharing this with Pastor Ronald. We were laughing about it. You know, I grew up in a Pentecostal background. And when we were growing up in a retreat, you know, I'm not trying to see any differences with denomination, but this is my story. This is me. When we were growing up, you know, like all of us are raising our hand and we're really speaking in tongues and we're even encouraged to prophesy, you know, and we were in a youth retreat and all of a sudden, you know, the preacher preached and all of us are speaking in tongues and all those things. And we started prophesying. And some of the prophesying was during that time in our camp, you know, some of us are losing soap and shampoos. I don't know who's taking those soaps and shampoos, you know. And while we're doing the prophesying, you know, teacher, si Pastor Ronald na kumuha na shampoo mo. Dina, si ganito mapapangasawa mo, sinabi sa akin ng Lord. God spoke to me, you know, you're going to marry him. I'll tell you later. And you know what? One thing is, for us to really know we're in the center of God's will, we have to constantly read His Word. You cannot determine God's will if you don't spend time reading God's Word. God will not just whisper that in your heart. You know, you need God's Word because this is the finished Word of God. And you need to be communing with God daily. You have to fellowship with the living God. You have to keep praying with Him. Because I believe when you do that, when we are in tune with God every single day of our life, God will direct us to the right path. The Word of God says that every step we will make will be directed by God. It will always be confirmed by His Word. You know, when young people says, you know what, Pastor, you're right. God confirm it. It's really Inday who is His will for me. He's courting Inday. I said, really? God spoke to you that Inday? Yes, I have read it. I have read it in the passage in Psalm 16:11. In Thy presence, Lord, there is fullness of joy. So I know it's Inday. See, God confirms it through His Word. Don't just point. Don't just turo on the Word of God. All right? We have to daily study it. Meditate on it in our life. And not only that God confirm it through His Word, God confirm it through other people as well. God confirm it. You know, my message today, let me just tell you. Last Friday, we had a Bible study. And you know whom God used to confirm the message? It was Alan, a 12-year-old boy. Is Alan here? Or downstairs? Oh, Alan was here. I don't want to, you know. But before we start the Bible study, we're kind of like sharing. Does God do something for you tonight or the whole week that He spoke to you in your devotion? And Alan shared to us, you know, that message that he had in his devotion. That you know what? When we pray to the Lord, God doesn't remove our troubles right away. And whoa! I said, like, Alan, you want to preach my message? That's a confirmation. God used other believers to confirm that you are in His will. And not only that, in the messages of God, you know, that we hear every Sunday, God will confirm it. And not only that, God confirms that you are in the center of His will through our circumstances. You know, a lot of us made a mistake when we say circumstances. What we were thinking is that all our circumstances will be good. We're thinking like when we are in the center of God's will, all our circumstances will be smooth sailing. No. When we talk about circumstances, when you are in the center of God's will, God orchestrates those circumstances so that God uses those circumstances to direct you to where He is taking you and me. It's not about good. It's not about comfortable. It's not about bad. It is God directing us through those circumstances in our life. But what happened while we are in the center of God's will and things started to fall apart? What happened when we are in the center of God's will and all of a sudden things happen differently? You know, to some of us, we ask. To some of us, we question. Well, some people, they question because they just want to know what God's plan is. But some people, when they ask questions, they doubt. Be careful. Watch out for doubt. Because the moment you start doubting, God, you will doubt His promises in your life. You cannot separate the promise of God and God. You understand that? The promise of God and God will always be together because the promises of God is the Word of God. And you cannot separate that from Him. When He says it, when you doubt the promises of God, you are doubting the God who made the promise. You cannot say, you know what? I'm trusting God, but I'm not sure of the promise. No, 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 you can't say that. Because when you trust God, you will know and trust the promises of God. And we have to stand in the promises of God. Now, why do we doubt God's promise? Why do we doubt God's promise in our life? Number one, we doubt God's promise when things happen differently the way we want it. We doubt God's promises in our life when things happen differently the way we want it. You see, what happens is when we follow God's call in our life, sometimes we are thinking that these things are the one who will happen to us. Sometimes there is also, you know, that thing already built in us. You know, one thing is, we, pastor, when we follow God's calling in our life, there are times that we are expecting things will happen this way. And God teaches us a lot of times in this area of our life. Because many times we want it to happen this way. But you know what God will do? He will do it this way. Why? Surprise. You know, one thing about this journey, there's a lot of surprises. There's a lot of youth who wanted to enter the full-time ministry. It's because of one thing. You know, they say, you know what? I wanted to be in the full-time ministry because those pastors, they have beautiful wives. Yeah. So even though I'm not that handsome, you know, even though I'm not that good-looking, it's good to be a pastor. Because all those young girls will cling to the bones to me. You see, they thought that when you follow the Lord in the ministry, you have these things, you know, God has something for me, this beautiful, you know. And this is how I believe God will bless me. When things happen differently, the way we want it to happen without God's promises in our life. Secondly, we draw our own blueprint based on our interpretation of the promises of God. We draw our own blueprint based on how we interpret the promises of God. Our interpretation of the promise of God sometimes is based on convenience. We think that the promises of God is about convenience in our life. When I follow God's calling, I will be convenient. Sometimes we think it's about comfort. Let me tell you, some of us will think that if I follow God, everything will be comfortable. When I follow God, everything that I like will be given to me. Let me tell you, when these things happen, then we start to doubt God's promises in our life. I remember when God called me to the Middle East, to Qatar. You know, I will be honest with you. I am so excited during the process. You know why? Well, I know that God is placing that burden in my heart. I know that God will take me to the Middle East. I have confirmed it with His word. I confirm it with the preachers, with every single circumstances in my life. During the process, I was excited. You know why? First is, I said, like, I will be earning U.S. dollars. Because even though it's the Middle East, we're earning dollars, you know. Wow. Exciting. Yes, I will be in a mission, but I will be, you know, getting dollars. And the second reason why I'm so excited is because that's the first time I will ride an airplane going to other countries. All right, so I'm kind of excited about it. But when we started having seminar in the POEA, and this person who did the seminar to us told us, you know what, let me tell you, you cannot do worship in that country. You cannot bring Bibles with you. You cannot bring any religious materials with you. Man, I'm telling you, I was dead scared. That was the first time I was so scared that, because I don't know Middle East yet. That's the first time I was going to Middle East. I said, like, God, do you really call me there? You know, like, no Bibles, no literature, no fellowship. I know there's fellowship there. I heard there's underground fellowship there. But, you know, I started asking God. Is this really your will? You know, it's easy to go to a place, if you're doing a mission, it's easy to go to a place that you like. If, example, you're in the Philippines, you know, God, you say that God calls you to America to do mission. Well, America is different. Or you're in America, God calls you to a mission in the Philippines. It's easier. I like Philippines. But when God calls you to a place where you don't know anything and you are restricted in worship and, you know, you're restricted to do things, let me tell you, you start to ask God. And the second doubt I had is during the departure. When I was about to depart, I said, like, God, I'm really scared. I don't know if this is really your will, you know. You know why I'm scared? I was asking for God's confirmation if he really called me to the Middle East. Guess what? God gave me a batch mate. We are one batch to depart from Naiya. There's about 10 of us, our batch, going to Qatar. And let me tell you this. Man, I was surrounded with people who were questionables. If you've seen the movie Expendables, they're good, you know, they're good. But I'm surrounded with people who are questionables. One of my batchmate who were with me is about to leave with me. You know, it was his first time being separated from his childhood sweetheart. That's already his fiance during that time. And let me tell you this, 2 hours saying goodbye in the airport. And he called me. Can you bring my bag to the plane? I just need to say one more thing. I say, God, what? You're taking me with these people? And there's another one of my batchmates, you know, he's very young, and there's nothing in his mouth. And, you know, he only mentioned one thing. Oh, I will be meeting new girls in Qatar. Wow, I know there's a lot of girls in there. I said, God, you really called me there with these people? And there's this third young people, I guess he's young, and he's 25, you know, he just got married, and his wife was pregnant, and we're about to leave. His wife is, I believe, is 7 or 8 months pregnant, and we're about to leave to Middle East. My God, I can't understand the picture of him and his wife in the airport. And guess what? Oh, we haven't left yet, and he's already homesick. And I'll be honest with you, literally speaking, he was carrying a portrait of his wife. You think I'm kidding? No, I'm not kidding. He cannot put that in the luggage, so he hand carried the portrait of his wife. All right? Unfortunately, I was sitting with him in the airplane. And the moment we sat in that airplane, he put that portrait in front of us. So I'm doing like that, and in front of me is a big portrait of his wife. And God, did you call me to that place again? I'm surrounded with these troubled people. I didn't realize we already took off. I arrived in Qatar. Lo and behold, when the door of the airplane opened, Lord, is there any tricycle here? I want to go back. Oh. During the time, there's no tube yet. We have to use the stairs. And when that door opened, lo and behold, in front of me is nothing but desert. And I asked God, Lord, do you really want me here? There are times in our life that we doubt God's calling in our life. When things happen not the way we thought God's will is look like, we doubt his promises. We doubt the God who made the promise. You know, this is what happened to Abraham. When God called him to the promised land, when he already settled in Canaan, the promised land, and the famine struck, Abraham doubted God. A lot of you will say, Pastor, I didn't see that in the Bible, that Abraham doubted God. Yes, we didn't read of that. I'll take you to that. But what happened when we doubt God's promise? Number one that will happen, one thing is we do things our own way. When we doubt God's promises in our life, we do things our own way. Abraham left Egypt, left Canaan to go down to Egypt. Abraham left the promised land. And I believe that this is not what God wants him to do. But he did it. Let me take you to four reasons why I believe that Abraham did something that is not according to God's will. Number one, during the time, Egypt is a symbol of the world system. During the time, Egypt is the symbol of financial security of the land. During that time, Egypt is the symbol of life. It is a symbol of self-confidence. It is a symbol of pride. It is the symbol of world intellect. In fact, if you will open your Bibles in Isaiah chapter 31, verse 1, God cursed Egypt. It says, "Woe to those who go down to Egypt for help, who rely on horses, who trust in the multitude of their chariots and in the great strength of their horsemen, but do not look to the Holy One of Israel or seek help from the Lord." One thing about Abraham is because he decided to go to Egypt, it's because there is security in Egypt. Right now, there is a famine here in God's will. Right now, there is something wrong here in the center of God's will. I have to go down to rely on the systems of Egypt. That's number one. And second is that one thing about Abraham is that in every moving that Abraham does, he always hears from God. But you will see that from chapter 12 to the rest of the chapter, it's only in chapter 12 that he didn't receive any instruction from God to move. In fact, his son Isaac in Genesis chapter 26 experienced the same kind of thing. And if we go to, turn your Bibles, Genesis chapter 26. Very quick. Genesis chapter 26. This is the son of Abraham, Isaac. Verse 1. Now there was a famine in the land beside the earlier famine of Abraham's time. And Isaac went to Abimelech, king of Philistines, in Gerar. Listen to verse 2. The Lord appeared to Isaac and said, "Do not go down to Egypt. Live in the land where I tell you to live. Stay in this land for a while, and I will bless, and I will be with you and will bless you. For to you and your descendants I will give all these lands and will confirm the oath I swore to your father Abraham." One thing about going to Egypt, I believe God gave instruction. And let me tell you this. With Isaac, we can see here that God told Isaac the same thing. Isaac was in Canaan, and God says, "You know what, Isaac? I know there's a famine in this land, but I don't want you to go to Egypt." Why? Because I don't want you to rely on them. I don't want you to rely on them. Third, this is the third reason why I believe Abraham learned to do things his own way, is this. Whenever Abraham settles, he built an altar to the Lord. You will notice that in verse 12, in chapter 12, verse 1 onward. Whenever Abraham settled in one place in that promised land, Abraham will build an altar to the Lord and he will worship God in that altar. Let me tell you this. When Abraham went to Egypt, he didn't build an altar to the Lord. So I believe that he is really out of God's will in this move. And the fourth, and then I will go to the second point. When we do things our own way, we start lying. Right? He started lying. Well, let me tell you, the second point, what happened when we doubt God's promise. The second point in what happened when we doubt God's promise is this. We rationalize with God. You know, we rationalize with God. You know what Abraham said? "You know what, Sarai? You're so beautiful." And the thing is, let me tell you this. Abraham premeditated this. All right? This event didn't happen just on a snap. "Oh, you know what? Because I am caught on guard, I lied." No, listen carefully. They were just walking on their way to Egypt, and Abraham already meditating something in his mind. You know what he's saying? "You know what, man? If I go to Egypt, they will see my wife. And my wife is beautiful. I don't know how Abraham looks like. But you know, they see that my wife is beautiful. And when the Egyptian sees my wife and learn that she is my wife, she is my wife, then they will kill me. So you know what Abraham did? Oh, Sarai, by the way, can we talk a little bit? You know, you're beautiful. Binola pa eh. You know, among ganda mo, han. You're so beautiful. But there's a problem. When we go there, because you're beautiful, they might take you as wife. And guess what happened to me? They will definitely kill me. Because Abraham knew traditions in Egypt. Because Abraham knew when they arrive in Egypt, they might like Sarai. And when they like Sarai, they might kill you, the husband. So what happened? Abraham started thinking something. Tell them, you're my sister. You know, right? You're my sister. But, well, Sarai is a half-sister of Abraham. You can see that in Genesis chapter 20, verse 12. Say, you know what? Don't say you are my wife. Say you're my sister. You know what? What would you feel if you wife, you know, you're traveling with your husband and your husband decided to remove the ring, put in their pocket and say, "Hon, you know what? When we arrive in that place, don't tell them you're my wife. Tell them you're my sister in the Lord." Wow. Isn't that great? Tell them you're my sister in the Lord. Anyway, that's true, right? You're my sister in the Lord. Well, I'll be honest with you. With Abraham, he decided to premeditate that thing because he is already doubting the promises of God. So he started rationalizing with God. You know, a lot of us will say it's a white lie. Let me tell you, this is not a white lie. All right, there's no such thing as white lie or black lie. Fly lie, yes. Not white lie or black lie. There's only one, it's a lie. Half-truth is lie. Half-truth is lie. You see, he's like, you know what? Let's say this, you're my sister. Because he is already doubting the promises of God. You know the third thing that happened when we doubt the promises of God? We started thinking of ourselves alone. We started thinking about ourselves alone. In Genesis chapter 12, verse 12 and 13, it says here, "When the Egyptian sees you, they will say, 'This is his wife,' then they will kill me, but will let you live. So say you are my sister, so that I will be treated well for your sake, and my life will be spared because of you." Listen. If they know that you are my wife, they will kill me. So say you are my sister, so that I will be set free, and then I will be treated well. Have you thought of that? Ginawa mong bait yung asawa mo. Ginawa mong pain yung asawa mo sa Egypt. You know what? Tell them you're my sister, so I will be treated well. You know one thing about Abraham? I'm not sure if he really knows what God wants for us as a family. We're supposed to love, well, in the New Testament, we're supposed to love our wife just as Christ loved the church. And we must be willing to die just like Jesus Christ died for the church. I believe that's the same concept that God was telling them in the Old Testament. But let me tell you this. During this time, you know what Abraham is trying to tell us in this particular thing that happened? He is telling us, you know what, hon, it's okay if Pharaoh will take you as wife. Because Abraham knew that they will take Sarai as the Pharaoh's wife. So Abraham was saying, you know what, hon, it's okay. You know, you're okay there. In harem, they call it harem. You know, Pharaoh has a lot of wives, and that house where they have the Pharaoh's wife is called harem. All right? You know, it's okay if you're the 20th wife of the Pharaoh. Anyway, I will be treated well. Hello? Are you willing to give up your wife? Some of you will say, amen. One thing about Abraham, he started thinking about himself. He forgot to think about his wife. He almost lost his wife. And not only that, he almost lost his wife. He almost lost the promised seed. Because you have to understand that the promised seed is through Sarai. If Sarai remains the wife of Pharaoh, he will lose the promise. You know, one thing is, when we start to doubt God's promise, we become sensitive and we only think of ourselves. You know a bat? Yung mga panike, the bat? They say that the bat is emitting a sensor in their body. You know, bat. They're emitting sensor in their body. And the solar sensor that they emit is their kind of like protection. Like when you get a stick and you see a bat flying, all right? When you see a bat flying, when you hit a bat, you know what? The moment that stick will hit the bat will automatically move like that. Because the bat is transmitting a sensor that before you hit the bat, you will be hitting the sensor. That thing that it transmits from its body. And when you hit that sensor, the bat will automatically fly away. There's a lot of believers who are Batman. You know that? When we doubt God's promises in our life, we become like Batman. You know, we just think of ourselves. We easily sense that we are in danger, but not our loved ones. We are willing to exchange our wife. Abraham was willing to exchange his wife so that he will be treated well. Number four, when we started doubting God's will, we started acquiring worldly wealth from our own way, and that is Genesis chapter 12, verse 6. You know what happened there in 12:6? 12:16? It says there in 12:16, he treated Abraham well for her sake, and Abraham acquired sheep and cattle, male and female, donkeys, manservant and maidservant, and camels. Guess what? His wife is in Pharaoh's house, almost sobbing, almost crying, because, you know, her husband is not beside her. And here's Abraham acquiring a lot of things, you know, donkeys, you know, like he's trading. And, whoa, can you do that? Like, Sarai can't sleep, and Abraham is really trying to gather all this worldly wealth. Sheep, cattle, donkeys, maidservant, and manservant. We started acquiring worldly wealth from our own way. The fifth, when we doubt God's promises in our life, this is what happened. We forget to worship. We forget to set up the tabernacle. As I have told you, when Abraham goes to one place, he set up a tabernacle and worship God. When you are out of God's will, when you do things your own way, you forget to set up your worship altar and worship the Lord. What is our Egypt? Is there any Egypt in our life right now? Is there any famine that is happening in our life right now? Maybe some of us are asking God, God, am I really in the center of your will? God, am I really following you right? But why am I experiencing this famine in my life? What do we do when things that is happening around us tends us to doubt God's promises and we are tempted to make move which is not sure if it is the will of God? I'll just give you 3 points. When we are doubting God's promises and we are almost ready to move our own way, and we're not sure if it is God's will or not, only 3 things we must do. Number one, we have to seek on God's clear instruction. We have to seek God's clear instruction in our life. I believe it says in Psalm 37:23, the step of a righteous man is ordered by God. If you seek God with all your heart, if you keep seeking His word, God will reveal to you when you are already making a wrong move. One thing with Paul, we know that Paul is ready to die, right? Apostle Paul, he is ready to die. Oh, he says, you know what? I am willing to die. In fact, every day, my life is almost dying. Why? Because a lot of people are trying to kill me. But you know what? There's an instance in Paul's life in Acts chapter 16, verse 6 and 7, when the Spirit says to him, no, don't go to that place. It's a danger. And Paul learned to acknowledge that, and he didn't go, even though he's ready to die. Because Paul is sensitive to God's instruction in his life. We have to ask God's clear instruction. And I love Moses so much, because Moses in Exodus chapter 33, he says to the Lord, you know what, God? If your presence will not go with us, better not to leave this place. Because what is the promised land? It means nothing if your presence is not there. So if we are not sure, we have to ask God's clear instruction. Lord, you know what? If you are not here, if your presence is not here, it will not be clear to me that you want me to go in that place. Let me tell you this. It's better for me to stay here than to be in that place and still out of your will. If it will not be clear to us to move, better for us to stay. We seek on God's clear instruction. Secondly, we have to be patient in waiting the Lord. Wow. I know this is our weaknesses, right? Patience. You go to a mall, there's a long line, you become impatient. Ano ba naman yung mga teller na yun? Napakabagal naman mga teller na parang di sinusweldoan. You know, when I drive my wife to work, Han, you better hurry up. I'm already 10 miles over the speed limit. You know, I'm already late. You know. Oh, because the traffic light, it turns red again. That's why I'm getting late. No, you woke up late. It's not about the traffic light. It's not about the line, you know. We have to learn to be patient in waiting on the Lord. Isaiah chapter 40, 31. They that wait upon the Lord will renew their strength. They will mount up with wings like eagles. They will walk. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and never faint. That's the promise. In Psalm chapter 37, verse 7, be still before the Lord and wait patiently for Him. Do not fret when men succeed in their ways, when they carry out their wicked schemes. We have to learn to be patient with the Lord, because let me tell you this. In the process, God will develop a relationship between Him and us, waiting on the Lord. And while we wait on the Lord, do not compromise our testimonies. Do not compromise our testimonies. Psalm 37, 34. Wait for the Lord and keep His ways. He will exalt you to inherit the land. When the wicked are cut off, you will see it. Meaning, you know, when it is your testimony is being compromised just because you are not sure, then don't compromise your testimonies. You don't need to lie. One thing is we compromise our testimonies. We become narrow-minded. We become narrow-minded. And third, and I will close here. What do we do when we start to doubt God's promise, and we start to move a step that is not in accordance to God's will? Number three, we learn not to trust the situation, but the Word of God. Listen carefully. Learn not to trust the situations in your life, but learn to trust the power of the Word of the living God. The situation might be deceiving. We might interpret troubles. We might interpret trials. We might interpret storms to be an indication that we are not in God's will. But let me tell you, not all the time. There will be times that you're in the perfect center will of God, and you will still be experiencing troubles. You will still be experiencing trials. You will still be experiencing storms. But you have to learn not to trust in those situations. It says in Psalm 34, 19, a righteous man may have many troubles, but the Lord delivers him from them all. You know what that means? Even though you are God's children, you might experience troubles in your life. But let me tell you, the promise of God is He will deliver you. What does it mean that He will deliver you? It means that God will carry you through. God will carry you through. Yes, you might be entering the storm. Yes, you might be entering the troubles, those sufferings in your life, but God will deliver you. You know, the best illustration that God always used is that He carries Israel with His hand and transported them to the other side. God will do that to you. He will carry you, will deliver you, even in the midst of that storm. You just have to learn not to trust the situation. I always love this illustration. One thing in flying is there is what we call the ILS, the instrument landing system. You know, you might be wondering how come airplane flies even in bad weathers. You know, I had this encounter West Palm Beach. I was flying a plane and I was in the middle of a great storm. And you know, one thing is it's so scary. You don't see anything but dark pitch black clouds surrounding your airplane. Let me tell you, there is an instrument, what we call the instrument landing system. The instrument landing system, there's an instrument called glide slope and localizer. It is a bar that goes like that, and there's another bar that goes like this. All you need to do is tune the instrument to the ILS of that airport. If the ILS of that airport is 117.5, dial 117.5 in your scope in that instrument panel, and that thing will move, and this thing will move, and then they will stop. And all you need to do is just follow it and make it be in the center. You know, when this bar is to the right, it means your plane is to the left of the runway. All you have to do is gear your plane to the right, and this one will move to the center. It means even though you don't see anything outside, you know that you're in the middle of the runway. And you know that the horizontal bar that goes up and down, that is the glide slope. And that glide slope, all you have to do, when that glide slope is up, it means your airplane is low. So all you have to do is climb a little bit, and when you climb, that horizontal bar will start to go down until they meet in the middle. When they meet in the middle, you locked it in. You're in a glide slope. Let me tell you this. Keep following that cross, and you will see yourself, boom! You'll be right there in the middle of the runway. And you are so safe, even though you don't see anything outside, even though those outside feels like it's a bumpy ride, even though it's outside feels there's a storm, you know, you don't see anything. But if you follow that cross, let me tell you this, you will be in the right path. But what God has want for us, learn not to trust what we see outside. Learn not to trust what you see outside of that mirror. You have to learn to focus yourself to God and His promises. His great promise, He didn't promise us that in this journey there will be no storms. He didn't promise us that in this journey there will be no fire. He didn't promise us that in this journey there will be no trouble. He didn't promise us that in this journey there will be no trials. He didn't promise us that in this journey there will be no giants. But His promise is this: I will never leave you nor forsake you. Even in the midst of that famine, I will never leave you nor forsake you. And it says in Philippians 4:19, I will supply all your needs according to His glorious riches in heaven. You know one thing about Canaan that Abraham didn't know before? Abraham is living just because of God's mercy and His grace. Because Canaan, the only thing that water Canaan is the rain. And how can you have rain in the Middle East, you know? But God, in His right time, He pour out rain. And He supplies every crops in that land. Let me tell you, God will supply all your needs, even in the midst of that famine. And the last promise, Romans chapter 8, verse 28. All things work together for good to them that love God and are called according to His purpose. All things work together for good. Not all things are good, but all things work together for good. All things, because God will use even that famine for your own good. God will use every trials you have in your life for your own good. But you have to learn to stand in the promises of God. Or you might say, but Abraham failed. Yes,
Abraham failed. He lied. He acquired wealth. You know, he abandoned his wife to Pharaoh. But let me tell you how faithful God is. There are times in our life that we fail. Many times in our life, we don't trust the promises of God. But you know, there are times in our life when we are faithless. God remains faithful. You know what he did? He sent plague to Pharaoh. But some people say, but how come Pharaoh received the disease? How come Pharaoh received the plagues? He didn't do anything wrong. You know, well, it's because during that time, Egyptians believed that when you are experiencing diseases in your life, your God is punishing you. There is something wrong with you. So that is a way that God tries to awaken the Pharaoh. And let me tell you, when Abraham failed, God remains faithful. He sent disease, plague to Pharaoh so that he can keep Sarah. Even though her husband failed, God's hand is still with her.